Saturday, so not close.
Good evening. Welcome. Thank you for coming this evening to our boards and commission member training. My name is Mark Wolf. I'm the Assistant City Manager for the city. We are recording this evening, so please be on your best behavior. What we're hoping to do, and I think it's been a while since the city's done this, is to try and educate all of our board and commission members on, you know, really some of the laws, rules, procedures, some tips on how to run an effective meeting. We think that this can really help us going forward across the board, and whether it's something as you know, casual as talking about how to clean up the city versus something much more complicated, zoning matter, we think this training is for everybody. So we're going to jump into it in a second here. Also be introducing Allison McKinney Brown, our city attorney, who will help out this evening with the presentation. But first, I don't want to have everybody introduce themselves. That might take all night. But if you could just give me a sense of one of your representatives from your committee. What boards and commissions are in the room this evening? So,
Urban Renewal Authority.
Great.
Urban Transportation Advisory.
Historic Preservation Commission.
Cultural Arts Commission.
Budget Advisory Committee.
All the way in the back.
Keep Equal with People.
Coming around this way.
Ace.
In the back.
Library Board.
Election Commission.
Zoning and Planning.
Great.
Fields and Adjustment.
Parks and Rec.
Alley Trust Fund Committee.
Nice.
Non-emergency Retirement Plan.
All right. Sure.
City Council.
Lobster.
Great. That's a good chunk of them. I think we have 20, so majority of our boards and commissions are in the room. Majority of our city councils in the room, so thank you.
Well, I don't want my Inglewood Housing Authority to not be recognized.
No, no,
it was more than just in though, so you've got a lot more boards and commission members here than are willing to admit, apparently.
Fair enough.
Also, you did run out of some packets, Mark.
Yeah, we're out of packets.
Packets, not everybody got them, so if you have an opportunity to provide that during the meeting.
Yeah, we can get a set of packets available. We have some staff in the audience that I think are going to help me. Thank you, Debbie. Okay, thank you for doing that. Good to know who's in the room. So the agenda will go through a few different areas tonight, starting with some basics on open meetings, open records. We're going to introduce to you what are called Bob's Rules of Order. Really, it's a suggestion for how to run your meetings. And I'm not suggesting that you aren't running your meetings effectively as it is, but Bob's Rules of Order is a really simple way to keep procedure, especially when matters get a little bit more complicated. So we'll dive into Bob's Rules of Order a bit. We'll talk about agenda setting and the role of the chairperson. A lot of our meeting today is geared towards talking about the role of the chairperson. If there's any, quote, changes to procedures going forward or suggested changes for all of you, it is in, I would say, reinstating or reminding of the role of the chair. Interaction with city council, all boards and commissions, you are bodies of, for the most part, bodies of, or authorized by the city council, so it's important to know your role in interacting with city council. And then talk a little bit briefly about roles and responsibilities of all members. And lastly, we have a slide on some specific parameters that more or less a reminder for our quasi-judicial boards and commissions. And we have some time for questions and answers. All of this, our content this evening, is about an hour. So we'll try to get you out of here in about an hour, unless there's extra questions, and we're happy to hang around. Sound good?
Yes.
All right. So I'm going to introduce Allison McKinney Brown. She is our city attorney. She's going to talk to you a bit about open meetings law, and then we'll kind of tag team from the rest of the way out.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So I want to do open meetings law in a nutshell, because most of it, honestly, you're not all that worried about. But the specific section of the open meetings law that I think is important to remind everybody about is the definition of a meeting. So by state law, any kind of gathering convened to discuss public business in person, by telephone, electronically, or by other means of communication of either a quorum or three or more members, whichever is fewer. So if you happen to be on a three-member committee, your quorum of two would be enough. And it's anytime any public business is discussed and or when any formal action may be taken. So it's there's a lot of moving parts within that definition. But what I want you all to know is that as boards and commissions, you are public bodies. You are subject to the Open Meetings Act. And when you're getting together to discuss the business of your board or commission, and there are, again, a quorum for a very small board or commission, but typically three or more of you present, that needs to be posted as a meeting. I want to be very clear about this. You live in a community. You interact with each other socially at church. You bump into each other at the Walmart. And you talk about all sorts of things. How's the kids doing? Are you going to go to that PTA meeting? That's not a meeting. You may be with two other members, but you're not discussing the business of your board or commission. So you don't need to worry about that. If you think, hey, the four of us want to be part of a golf team, be part of a golf team. Just don't discuss the business of your board or commission, which is relatively simple. It makes your life easy. You get to focus on your golf game. You don't have to worry about what's going on with planning and zoning or what's going on with keeping Inglewood beautiful. Focus on whatever it is you're supposed to do. That's fine. But if you know that three or more members of your body are going to be getting together to discuss the business of your body, the chair needs to be notified in the first place, because at that point we're talking it's a special meeting. So if you know that's going to happen, let the chair know, and let the chair figure out how the chair wants to handle that. Typically, what we'd like is that no meetings occur unless they are called, unless they're your regular meeting, which are always scheduled, or a special meeting, workshop meeting called by your chair. That just makes everything cleaner under the Open Meetings Act. Meetings like tonight, I didn't request that this be published. We're getting together to talk about administrative actions. What does the Open Meetings Act require? What's Bob's rules? That's not the business of your board or commission. There's no decisions that are going to be happening here. So this really doesn't count as a meeting of your body. But if three of you from the same body are sitting together, I'm going to pick on planning and zoning just because they're an easy one to remember. The planning and zoning, we're all sitting together and talking about, boy, what do you think about that PUD that's coming up? Yeah, that would be a problem. Don't do that. Some of you set your regular meetings by bylaws. I think a couple of you have set them in other manners. Once you've set your regular meeting, it's set. And if you want to change your regular meeting, that's fine, as long as it's not set by code or charter. Go back to your bylaws and publicly change it. Change your bylaws. That's fine. But the public has a right to know when to anticipate those meetings are going to be happening. And under open meetings, it gets to be a question of violation of open meetings if there isn't an ability for the public to know when a meeting is going to happen. So if you've got a scheduled regular meeting, stick to your regular meeting, because that's the best way to notify the public, and notice is required under the Open Meetings Act. The other element of notice is that if there is going to be a meeting, the agenda of the meeting should be created in advance. And we're going to be talking about how far in advance. That's Marcus to cover those details. But it should be created in advance and posted with the meeting notice. And in that way, you've notified everyone who's interested exactly what business is before the body. Be very careful about taking up off-agenda items. If there's any way not to take up an off-agenda item, I encourage you to not do that, to recognize that there's issue A, and to set it for the next regular meeting, or if it's an emergency, set it for a special meeting. But be very careful about taking up off-agenda items, because if they haven't been noticed in advance, the public doesn't know it's going to happen, and they can't come and participate if it's something that's important to them. Any other than notice and meeting times and what exactly is a meeting, are there any other questions that come up out of your boards and commissions about Open Meetings Act? Yeah.
Can you address email votes?
Yes, be happy to.
Good.
So, under state law, I'm going to repeat this because I think this startles people. Under state law, meetings don't have to take place in person. I mean, traditionally, that's what we do, but the state law says that's not the only form of a meeting. A meeting can include telephone, electronic communication, or any other means of communication. It is pretty common for boards and commissions of this city to want to have a special meeting to approve minutes, and they'll do that by email. So what happens is the chair needs to call that special meeting for a date and time certain and needs to notify everybody through, just like it was a regular meeting. We're going to have a special meeting at 4 o'clock on Friday the 12th by email for the limited purpose of approving minutes. It's posted, everybody knows. And then at 4 o'clock, the chairman sends out an email saying, at this time, please send in your vote concerning the draft minutes that have been submitted. And then everybody sends in their email over the next 15 minutes or whatever. At the end of however much time, the votes are tallied, and that information can be relayed or not relayed out to the body as a whole. It should be relayed out. And that's the end of the meeting. But there needs to be minutes. And again, under Open Meetings Act, minutes don't have to be verbatim. As a matter of fact, I discourage you from doing verbatim, because you can never pick up anyone's intent or anyone's, or the way people are interpreting what's being heard. So however you do that, the minutes should be, there was a special meeting on X day and X time that occurred by email for the limited purpose of approving draft minutes. Draft minutes were approved 4-3. Then the staff liaison will keep a copy of all of the emails that were part of that special meeting and attach them to that very short action of minutes. And then at your next regular meeting, you'll be asked to approve those special minutes. Anything else specific? One last thing is, open meetings questions that come up, any chair is welcome to send an email to the city attorney's office about an open meetings question, and we will get back to you very quickly on those. They're pretty, for the most part, those are questions that we can answer pretty quickly and get back to you. If you're asking us to write an ordinance, we try to get that done in 30 days, but if an open meetings question comes up, that's a question of law, and you guys need to have an answer to that. So do send an email request to the city attorney's office and we'll get some answer back to you. As long as you're trying to do things right, trying your best to do things right, there's no intent to violate the law, and that's pretty important. I think all of our goal is to conform to the law. But if you have a question, please ask. Yeah.
You mentioned, you said something about meeting minutes being approved 4-3. I've never been in a public meeting where minutes weren't finally at least approved unanimously by reaching a consensus, can it be approved just by simple majority?
Simple majority. We prefer unanimous. That means we're reflecting the. That's the thing. That's the thing about the minutes. Everybody's so used to looking at the video and saying, "Well, the video says." I don't care what the video says. The minutes are what the body approved, because it's what the body's perception of the meeting is, not what somebody watching the video says they saw. That's totally irrelevant. What does the body believe it approved? So, I'm with you. Typically, we see something unanimous because the whole body knows what it was they were acting on. Anything else? Okay, I'm going to turn this back over to Mark. Thanks.
Thank you, Allison. One more thing I wanted to add is just to be aware of what sometimes is referred to as a walking quorum or a chain quorum is when, especially electronically, you may ask one of your members or offer an opinion to another member on a particular matter that might be coming before the board. And then that member subsequently emails another member about your opinion and then their opinion. All of a sudden you have three members, even though you're not, the three of you aren't discussing the issue, you have three members that are now in a chain discussing an issue that will eventually be before the board or commission. So that also is a violation of the open meetings law. So just be aware of that especially, I mean, the bottom line is if you know something is going to come before the board commission for consideration, just be aware of the discussion you're having with other board commissioners prior to that discussion. All right, moving on to a few open records. Allison already touched on this, talking about action minutes. So the most important thing, in fact, what we encourage and what we encourage staff to reflect in their minutes are only the actions that happen. That's what we're concerned with. We don't want to try to characterize individual members' discussion as best we can. We will stick to action minutes. So keep in mind, and this is really important for chairpersons, that make sure you're able to repeat and articulate the action that is before the body. So if there's any confusion, hopefully, and our staff has been trained as such, to jump in and say, Madam, Mr. Chairperson, what was the action? What was the motion? But as a chairperson, make sure we articulate what the action is so we can reflect it in the minutes is important. Packet information, you all know this, but if you are presenting something or you know something will be presented, to double check that it is in iCompass, it's online, it's with the packet of information in advance of the meeting so the public knows what is being discussed. And then if there is information, and it always happens as best we try to prevent it, that is distributed at a meeting, that our staff is aware of it and is able to collect it. And if we have that information that was distributed at a meeting, we can provide that online for the public afterwards. And lastly, and you all know this, but I think it's just always good to repeat that as a board or commission member, your communications related to board or commission business is subject to open records requests. So keep that in mind use your discretion. I'll put it that way. Pick up the phone if you want to have a conversation. Anything other than that is written down could be subject to open records. So keep that in mind. All right. So switching gears a bit after the sunshine of open meetings and open records, we're going to talk a little bit about Bob's Rules of Order. So Bob's Rules of Order was designed by a city attorney in town named Bob Weicker. He actually spent some time with our city council recently to go through rules of procedure. not just because he was named Bob, but what he took was Robert's Rules of Order that many of you should be familiar with already. Excuse me. And if you're familiar with Robert's Rules of Order, there's a book that you can get that will guide you through Robert's Rules of Order. It's about this thick. So it is extremely complicated and for the most part is not useful for local government and especially boards and commissions. So what Bob did, Mr. Widener, was to essentially adapt Robert's Rules of Order to local government. And so we found it to be really useful, and what we're working with the city council currently is to get towards using Bob's Rules of Order. If nothing else, because it is simple and easy to understand. Robert's Rules, you can build 7 times on different motions and you have to keep a track of it. You should have a parliamentarian on the record that is able to clarify when something's gone awry with Robert's Rules of Order. It's just too much. So Bob's Rules are simple. That's why we're teaching it to you. It is certainly at your discretion as a board or commission whether or not to take our advice. We think it can be helpful to run a meeting, especially those that end up getting controversial. You have members of the public there that are there to comment, that are interested in the subject. Perhaps it's even quasi-judicial in matter. This can help organize your meeting, keep track of the order of things so that you're not only protecting the process, but you're protecting yourselves as board and commission members to make sure that you're running the process as it's intended to be. So hopefully this will help you. It's not meant to be punitive. It's simply a suggestion that I think would be nice for all board and commissions to utilize. One of the main aspects of Bob's Rules of Order is that the chairperson is the quote parliamentarian. In essence, they are the expert and responsible for running the meeting. So if you are a chairperson, newly elected, I believe most of our boards and commissions just elected chairpersons in February, learn these rules. And what we'll do with Bob's Rules of Order, I understand that you don't have them in front of you right now, we'll make them available clearly online. They've been in front of City Council a couple times, so if you're a very close watcher of the City Council, you'll know which meetings we've already talked with them about Bob's Rules, and they are available there already on iCompass, but we'll make Bob's Rules available online for you so you can see the full information. Additionally, there's a really handy table of motions and points, and we'll go through those, that can be helpful in guiding the meeting, not just for committee members, but especially for chairpersons to try to keep track of the nuances. So we'll make all that information available. If your bylaws define a different rules of order, so let's say it states in your bylaws that you will utilize Robert's Rules of Order, we encourage you to revise your bylaws accordingly if you are going to move forward with Bob's Rules of Order. And if you have any questions about if you have bylaws or what your bylaws say, if you're not sure where they are, let us know. We're happy to help you. So for chairpersons, it is important that you learn these rules. We're going to go through an example here in a little bit to help you see it in action, but it really is important for the chairperson to learn these rules. They will be the ones to guide the meeting and ultimately have the authority to say whether or not something's in or out of bounds in Bob's Rules of Order. I also don't want to scare those boards or commissions that are less formal. If you don't have members of the public coming, don't have contentious meetings, great, good for you. Don't feel like you have to adopt Bob's Rules of Order and all of a sudden have some rigidity in your meeting that you don't want. That's not the intention of this. They are flexible such that what Bob's rules say is that if you, as a board or commission, say, we use Bob's Rules of Order, but you know that you have a non-controversial agenda, you're discussing, you're planning an event or whatever, the chairperson can suspend the rules at the very beginning of the meeting and you proceed informally after that. And that's all you have to do. So if that's the case, I've been to a few of our boards or commissions that are casual like that, that is totally fine. We're not discouraging you from doing that. What it does do, and if you learn it, if you happen to have 90% of the time you're non-controversial and all of a sudden you get an issue referred to you by the city council that becomes a little bit contentious, you have a guide and you know what to do in that situation. So I've seen, unfortunately, not in this city, it spiral out of control when a chair or a body doesn't have a rule of order or doesn't understand their rules of procedure, and all of a sudden it's not productive for anybody, everybody leaves frustrated, the board of commission members feel frustrated, and so does the public. So hopefully this will help you avoid those situations if they ever come up. And for those that do have controversial issues all the time, it will help you at all your meetings. So, getting into some specifics, some basic requirements of Bob's Rules of Order. These should be familiar to all of you. All members need recognition for the floor. So the chairperson must recognize somebody to speak. One person speaks at a time. No side discussions. So again, one person speaking, two others are off to the side having a sidebar about the issue on the agenda or what they're going to have for dinner. Voting is yes, no. So under Robert's Rules of Order, there's abstentions allowed. I'm not going to vote here. Again, an abstention is counted as a no vote under Bob's Rules of Order. So that just, again, makes it simple unless there is a conflict of interest. That's, I believe, the one exception. So other than that, yes, no is the vote. No explaining your vote. So as a chairperson calls for a vote and we start going around the room, say, my vote is yes, and I'd like to just, again, urge my committee members, no. You've had the opportunity already to explain your vote before then in deliberation. It should be clear what your position is. By the time we get around to the vote, the vote's taken and you move on. All right, into a little bit of the specifics. There are basically two different actions that happen under Bob's Rules of Order: points and motions. First, motions. Three different types of motions, and motions must have a second. I make a motion to approve the ordinance proposal in front of us. There must be a second in order for it to continue. Otherwise, the motion fails. There's three different types. There's a privileged motion, what's called a privileged motion, a main motion, and a subordinate motion. We'll talk a little bit about the order of that in one moment. Points are different. All points are privileged motions, meaning they interrupt conversation, so to speak. They will be taken up immediately upon that point. And there's four different points. Now, if you go online and look up Bob's Rules of Order, you'll see three different points. We have added a fourth point that we think is useful at times, which is the last one, the point of decorum. Each of these points can be raised at any time. So you're in the middle of discussion and you feel like somebody's made a motion that is out of order, Mr. Chair, point of order, that point of order will be taken up immediately and a ruling on that point of order will be taken at that time. So looking at a little bit more specifically at the order, and once you have the chart in front of you, it'll make more sense, but each of the motions fall into different categories, whether they're privileged, main, or subordinate. And you handle them in that order. So a main motion is very straightforward. Typically, that's your main motion for any action that would happen at a meeting. So if you have an agenda item for whatever it might be, make a recommendation to City Council on X, the motion would be to recommend to City Council. Okay, that would be your main motion. And so if somebody were to interject a privileged motion in that during that discussion on that motion, you would have to take up that privileged motion or point that's raised. The subordinate would be something, and here's a few examples. Again, privilege is all points. Also, motions to recess or motions to go into executive session are privileged, so those will interrupt debate. The main motion, there's many different types. Main motions can take up hundreds of different forms, but there are 10 categories, if you will, that I'll show you on the next slide. And then the subordinate are your motions to amend the main motion, your continuance to a date certain, and a motion to call the question or call for a vote. So one important thing about Bob's Rules of Order that you should be aware of, and this is how it simplifies it, is that there is no building upon subordinate motions. So in other words, if somebody has a main motion on the floor, I move to recommend to City Council X, and somebody says, I'd like to make a motion to amend that, and I'd recommend why, okay? Well, you need to debate that motion, that motion to amend, before anybody else can make another motion. So in Robert's Rules, you could do that for a while before you have to ultimately vote on one of the motions. In Bob's Rules, there's only one amendment to the main motion, and you have to take up that amendment. So if somebody wants to have a different amendment, you have to wait, and the body has to deal with that amendment first before you get back to the main motion where you'd be able to make another amendment. Hopefully that made some degree of sense. Any questions on kind of the points and motions generally? I'll show you the main motions here in a moment. Okay, good. Hope that's because it's clear. All right. Types of main motions. And I'm not gonna go through either of these. A lot of these are pretty straightforward. Again, your main motion is the one that can be catered to what business is in front of the Board of Commission. So if that's a motion to recommend or approve or adopt or recommend, whatever it might be, you know, we make a motion that the block party is going to be on September 6th, whatever it might be. Your main motion is the one that is flexible to the specific action that you need to accomplish. These others are specified. Some of these, like motion to recess and executive session, are the privileged motions. Most of the rest of them under that, well, the rest of them under that are your main motions. And then on the right side there are your subordinate. Your motion to amend, your motion to continue to a date certain, so that's essentially postponing discussion. In essence, killing the item for the time being. And then your motion to call the question or close debate and get a vote on the matter. Again, only one subordinate motion is in order at one time. Okay, clear as mud. So I think what would be helpful is if we went through an example of kind of in action, what Bob's rules might look like. So, given that you're all active volunteers on Board of Commissions, I would imagine I have three volunteers this evening that would like to come up to the front and help me with an exercise on Bob's Rules of Order. There's one. There's two. One more. I don't want to have to pick randomly. And three. Thank you very much. All right. So, you all can kind of stand at the front here. Oh, I do. So, what we're considering this evening is the this is the Committee on Cats and Dogs up here, and in front of them this evening is a proposed ordinance to require sweaters for dogs in below freezing weather. And our participating members this evening are Chair Schnauzer. Member Golden, and Member Yorkie. So what we'll be doing is our Committee on Cats and Dogs will be taking up this issue utilizing Bob's Rules of Order, and they'll go through their script here, and then we'll kind of have a little discussion afterwards and make sure it's clear. Madam Chair, your floor.
I would like to move the Committee on Cats and Dogs onto our next agenda item, a proposed ordinance to require sweaters for dogs in below freezing weather. We have already received a staff presentation on this from Parks Director Beagle. I would like to open the floor for discussion.
I believe it is important for the city. Too many dogs are cold during the winter. I would like to make a motion to recommend the City Council approve of the proposed ordinance to require sweaters for dogs in below freezing weather.
Yeah, I got a point of information.
Your point of information is recognized, Member Golden. What is your point of information?
Is the temperature specified in the purpose proposed ordinance?
Yes, 32 degrees is the listed temperature in the ordinance. Back to Member Yorkie's motion. Is there a second?
I will second for discussion purposes.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to recommend to City Council approval of the proposed ordinance to require sweaters for dogs in below freezing weather. Member Yorkie, would you like to speak to your motion?
Watching a dog shiver in the cold is heartbreaking. This ordinance will prevent future suffering. I urge my fellow members to vote yes on this motion.
Yes, Member Golden, the floor is yours. I'll just talk about it.
I don't like to watch dogs shiver either, but not all dogs are the same. I would like there to be more flexibility in the proposed ordinance. I would like to make a motion to amend Member Yorkie's motion by changing the effective temperature to 25 degrees.
I will second for discussion.
I believe that small dogs are whips when it comes to cold.
I think it's supposed to be
whips. Oh, yeah. It definitely says whips. Not whipping. Not whipping dogs. When it comes to cold weather.
Chair Schnauzer, point of decorum.
I will second your point of decorum, Member Yorkie. Member Golden, please be respectful during this debate.
Whip as many dogs as I darn well.
I believe 25 degrees is too low for many dogs. I could agree to a compromise. Let's make a motion to amend Member Golden's amendment to 30 degrees.
Chair Schnauzer, point of order.
Yes, Member Golden, what is your point of order?
We cannot amend a motion to amend.
You are correct. The Member Yorkie's motion is out of order. We must first take care of Member Golden's motion to amend. Unless there is objection, I will call the question on Member Golden's motion to amend. Please vote.
Yes.
No.
No. The motion to amend to 25 degrees fails. The main motion to recommend approval is now in front of us. Unless there is an objection, I would like to call the question.
Would Member Yorkie consider a friendly amendment to include the motion the temperature required of 30 degrees?
Yes, I consider that a friendly amendment.
Okay, the motion before us, now amended, is a motion to recommend to City Council approval of the proposed ordinance to require sweaters for dogs in weather below 30 degrees. Please vote.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, the motion is approved. Thank you for your work.
Thank you.
Very good job. All right, so appreciate the levity on the subject. Any observations on kind of how they went through that you noticed in the example there?
It's hard to keep track of what was going on.
Yeah, maybe to slow down, especially as multiple motions are coming through.
I really liked how the chair repeated what the motions were.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. I think that is super helpful for chairs, is when, especially as motions are starting to go back and forth and debate is ramping up, to say, hold on a sec, just to clarify, the motion on the floor is to require sweaters in 30-degree weather, so that everybody knows what you're talking about, and if there was an amendment, that everybody knows that they're talking about the amendment or they're talking about the main motion. Absolutely. Under Bob's rules, you have to be recognized. So again, that's just to make sure that multiple people aren't talking over one another. You know, just at the end there to say, well, would it be a friendly amendment to add this? And you know, certainly if you have the other person just interject, yes, of course, that's friendly. You can keep discussion going like that. But especially as the debate starts to ramp up a little bit and emotions start to enter in, and dogs, we all know how that goes. I think it's important for the chairperson to assert themselves, to say, you know, hold on a sec, point of order, I will recognize those, the only members of this body that are authorized to speak are those members recognized by this chair. Just to try to say, one at a time, let's calm down and go through this debate some rational order. Anything else? Okay, so a little silly, but hopefully you saw how it can work and you understand the flow a bit. What we really like about some of the points is that they're simple, there's only four points, and it can help clarify along the way. So a point of information, I just want to know if you know this or that is included, or point of order if you think it's gone off base. What I didn't put in there, I thought it might get a little too complicated, is that in any situation where there's a point of order and the chair rules that, well, that motion's out of order, and the body disagrees, they don't agree with the chairperson's interpretation, the chairperson's ruling can be overruled by 2/3 vote of the rest of the body. Now, that's one of the more complicated pieces of this. That's just to say that The chairperson's in charge, the chairperson keeps the meeting going, but they don't have final authority over everything. That if there is a disagreement or they, you know, would allow the motion on top of a motion to amend, the rest of the body can say, hold on a sec, I'd like there to be a ruling or a vote of the body on the chair's ruling. So there is that backstop as well. Yeah?
If you're making a point of order or a point of decorum, are you supposed to wait until somebody's done speaking, or can you interject if it seems appropriate?
You may interject as soon as that comes up. The chair should recognize that. Now, if somebody's finishing a sentence or a statement, that certainly is allowable, but that's at the discretion of the chair. The way Bob's rules read is that as soon as that point is made, any of the privileged motions, including all points, then debate stops and that point is taken up.
Let's say during the course of the debate, kind of that friendly amendment came forward before the initial amendment was, voted down. Mm-hmm. Would that be, sometimes that happens in discussion. Do you need to have it go to like a final call to question on the original amendment only to then allow for the friendly amendment, or can that kind of compromise happen as a point to say, let's amend this real quick, or, come to a better consensus and then vote on that one?
So let's take our dogs example. If Member Yorkie offered the friendly amendment prior to the vote on the amendment to take it down to 25 degrees. You could note that and say, seems like there's consensus that we would be comfortable with 30 degrees. I mean, there's two ways to handle that, but the simplest is to take the action on the amendment. Since there's a motion on the floor to amend, have the committee vote that motion down, and then you have the main motion back in front of you where the friendly amendment can be added. The friendly amendment can't be added to the main motion after there's a motion to amend. So if you just think of it this way, that when there's an action, the body is dealing with that particular suggested action or motion. As soon as another suggested action is before the body properly, so somebody makes a motion to amend and seconds it, you can't kind of go back in time. You have a new action that the committee must deal with. So even if it's friendly, just essentially start sweeping, take care of the amendment, and get back to the main motion so you can offer the friendly amendments. And friendly amendments are always in order on a main motion. When they're not is if you have seven members and somebody objects to the friendly amendment. And so then you have to have a motion to amend and take a vote on that amendment. Right, so Allison just mentioned that at any point, so whomever moves the original main motion can withdraw that motion at any time. So it doesn't, and I think that's different than Robert's Rules of Order, where it becomes the property of the body as soon as the motion is seconded and before the body. You own your motion, so you can take it back at any time. Now somebody else could certainly come in and then make the same motion and have it seconded, but you can. You have that authority.
Regarding calling the question, is that so the chair was calling the question there? Does the person that makes the motion, do they still have the ability to call the question?
They can call the question. It is subordinate, so it depends when it is made. Essentially, if there's no objection to the motion, the second, then the question is called. If there is an objection, then there must be a vote on the motion to call the question. And in that case, I think, and I'll double check this, I think it's a two-thirds vote of the body to call the question under Bob's rules. Let me double check that. I have my thing up here. Yeah, it's two-thirds of the quorum present for the calling of the question. So debate's going on and on and on. Somebody is getting frustrated, wants there to be a vote. Say, Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion to call the question. Seconded.
Anybody can call the question.
Anybody can call the question. Seconded, and then there's a vote on that. Two-thirds of the members present vote in favor of the calling of the question, debate stops, and the vote takes place immediately.
So, sorry, if Yorkie had said no to the friendly amendment, at that point, would you be able to debate and like fine-tune whether it's 27 degrees or 31 degrees or something like that? Is that the time to debate? And
right, so at that point, if the amendment to take it from 32 to 30 wasn't friendly, then somebody would have to make a motion to amend to change the degrees. And certainly in discussion, you can be recognized by the chair and just state why you think it should be changed one way or another. But there would have to be a formal motion and a vote on that. Yes? Right. So again, you don't have to explain your vote one way or another. However, if there is discussion about whether or not or which way you're voting, or you're trying to convince your other committee members, instead of starting to go down the row and getting the votes from everybody, say, okay, we have the motion to call the question. Is there a discussion on that? And then you open the floor for discussion on. Calling the question is a bad example because I don't think there's discussion on calling the question. I think that's just a yes or no vote.
Quasi judicial is the
answer. But okay, so for those that are non quasi judicial, you're able to open the floor on closing the debate on other motions. Any motion we'd recommend for the chair is just to say, okay, there's a motion to recommend approval of this ordinance. Is there discussion on the motion? Instead of having people start to say, well, I'm going to vote yes, and here's why. Certainly, they could cover that in there and in the discussion period.
To clarify, there are a few of you here who are representing quasi-judicial boards, and when it's a quasi-judicial decision that's being made following the public hearing and that whole process, we really do want a statement on the record of the basis for your decision. It's having to hear us talk about Bob's rules makes it a whole lot more complicated than it really is. It's 9 pages. It's really not complicated. The little chart, it's just 1 page. So it's really easy to use. But the idea here is that a lot of people hold up the vote because if they're called on to make their vote, and then right then and there, they want to make a long speech again. Speech making happens during discussion. Then the decision is made. For quasi-judicial decisions, the chair really has to establish the basis for the decision, and that's part of the decision-making process. So when you think about the outcome of quasi-judicial hearing, don't confuse that with Bob's rules of order or any rules of order. You're handling it more as a judicial decision. So quasi-judicial, there's going to be differences just because you're working under a different set of rules.
Thank you. All right, we'll move on, and if there's questions on Bob's rules that come to you, we'll have a place for that at the very end. Thanks to our volunteers again. You did a great job, and City Council has a very important issue before them now. All right, role of chairpersons. We've covered a lot of this, but I'll just go through the highlights fairly quickly here. This is one thing that we've really emphasized with staff in our training this year, is that it is the chair, not the staff, that controls the business of the Board of Commission. And this is important, especially with agenda setting, but we as staff will always have, and whether or not it's past practice, I don't know, but staff will always have a conversation with you as the chairperson about business that is to be in front of the Board of Commission. And that is just, I think, best practice to say that these are not, Boards of Commissions are not staff functions. They're not extensions of the administration. What they are they're an extension of City Council. And so it's important that the chairperson, the person that the Board of Commission has put in charge of the business of the committee, remains in charge of the business. So we are still here as a resource to help put the agenda together, to make sure you have all the materials you need, the whole nine yards. We're not changing our role in that regard. But what we are asking is that, especially for agenda approval, that chairs are playing that role and saying, hey, here's what a proposed agenda looks like. I know these issues coming up. This was referred to us, whatever it might be, but the chairperson is giving their thumbs up on the agenda and making sure they know what's going on with the business of the board of commission. And so just a quick snapshot of the approval process for agendas. We are happy to develop that initial draft agenda, so you don't feel like you're starting from scratch as a chair. The agenda is then approved by the chair, and then we'll publish it. And we will note if an agenda is not yet approved, we'll put draft agenda on the top of it, just so the public's aware what is generated by staff versus what is already approved by the chair. And ideally, the week prior, we have approved agendas. So we'll talk a little bit more about that posting procedure. But I think if anything, any changes, so to speak, we're really emphasizing that role of the chair in committee business. Was a question over here?
You answered it the 1 week before your time.
Yeah, and I'll go through that in a little bit more depth. Canceling meetings, we've had some questions about how to cancel meetings in the past. There's two ways to formally cancel a meeting. One is that the chairperson cancels the meeting prior to the meeting time. You know you don't have a quorum, there's inclement weather, there's nothing on your agenda, whatever it might be. You as the chairperson has the discretion to cancel the meeting and to either notify the board of commission or notify staff that you as the chairperson is canceling the meeting, and we'll notify board of commission members and the public. The other is that the chair calls the meeting so that you're present at your meeting time that is posted, and you call the meeting to order and declare that there's a lack of quorum. So we encourage the latter if it is a matter of not sure on quorum. This again is just for, I think more than anything, for members of the public that intend to show up to your board of commission. If you're not sure, members running late, whatever that might be, there's a chance that they still are there in time and you can meet and business goes on. Better safe than sorry, especially if you're already planning on being here. I know that's sometimes annoying. But what we've gotten, what we've run into are bad situations where it feels like the staff is kind of arbitrarily canceling a meeting. It was 50-50, we weren't sure, but some of the board of commission members didn't know and they showed up and were ready to participate. So I think in general, if it's a quorum issue, unless you know for certain people are out of town, if it's a matter of, well, we're going to be really close on quorum, hold the meeting, and if you don't have quorum, call to order and announce that there's lack of quorum. Yeah?
On all the board and commissions, is a quorum a simple majority or are any super majorities required?
It's typically half of the committee plus one or three, and it's whatever's less.
No,
it's not.
Thank you.
The answer Mark just gave you was what constitutes a meeting. So if you're going to, you may have a committee of 10 people. If three people show up under open meetings law, that constitutes a meeting. But the question was, what constitutes a quorum? And I'm not aware, other than there's some zoning issues. Zoning, you're off in your own world. But other than some zoning issues, I'm not aware of any groups that have that require a supermajority in order to call a quorum. So someone can prove me wrong because they've got something weird out there, but I believe for everybody it's half of the group plus one, a simple majority, is a quorum.
And that's what's required to move forward with the meeting, is?
Yes.
Sorry for that. Thank you for the clarification. All right, moving on to posting procedures. Again, this is a little bit of a change, and I apologize for those that fall later in the week. It's a little bit more of a inconvenience, but hopefully it makes sense as to why we're suggesting this new procedure. Again, staff will develop a draft agenda. drafted agenda is approved by the chair. What we're asking our staff to do is have an approved agenda and materials for the packet of information posted to our online portal, iCompass, no later than 3 p.m. the Thursday a week prior. And
not
again,
7 days prior, just that week.
Just the week prior. Earlier the better, especially for us to have a draft agenda available a week prior so that we know we're interacting with the chairperson after that. There might be a delay in going back and forth on an agenda item or getting approval. This allows us to have an entire week of committees posted on the public agenda, on our boards, online, and the packet of information so that if I'm a member of the public reviewing the week ahead over the weekend and I'm interested in what's going on in city business, I can see each of the meetings and know what's on the agenda and see the packet of information. This also allows us at a staff level to know which are consistent meetings every month and if there's one missing to say, hey, what's going on? Why isn't there an agenda? So for chairs, just so you're aware, you'll be hearing from your staff members the week prior to your meeting to approve an agenda. And this is important too, because it is far in advance, things come up, you forgot that you were supposed to discuss something, you can always amend an agenda after the fact. Again, we want to try to avoid that as best we can, but stuff happens. And so just because you have a posted agenda to the public doesn't mean that it's set in stone, that we can amend an agenda afterwards. Okay? Yes, I'm talking about prior to the meeting, amending your agenda. Really before that 24-hour window is when it would be proper to amend the agenda. You should not amend your agenda on the fly at the meeting. Again, that gets back to off agenda topics, that the whole purpose of posting agenda items is so that the public knows what you're likely to discuss at your meeting. All right. Again, I'm not going to go through this because we talked about it, but action minutes, the adopted record is what is important. It is to promote consistency and recording requirements. So there's the minutes, that's one thing. That's the official record, that's what the Board Commission is saying happened. That doesn't mean that the recordings of the meetings aren't important. The entire discussion to get a sense of where a Board of Commission was at when they were deliberating. To that end, we're having recording equipment available at all boards and commissions so that we're able to put that online. So that'll just be a matter of staff policy. You should be aware of it, obviously, that you'll be recorded. At this point, we haven't really weighed in on subcommittees. I know that was a question. At this point, I don't think at a staff level that we're going around chasing down all the subcommittees for reporting. That'll be more or less at the discretion of the chair for now, unless we get other guidance on that. But for boards and commissions, we'll have recording equipment available. Your staff liaisons will have that, and they'll be posted online for public consumption. All right, moving right along. Interaction with city council. We are currently working with our city council members to refine some of the processes. So for now, until that is defined, what our suggestion is to present business to city council through your council liaison. So if you have something that you want to make a recommendation on, or you'd like city council to discuss as a body, to work with your council liaison on providing that. Another option is to write a formal memo or a letter from the chairperson asking the mayor or asking your council liaison to take the issue to the full city council. That's probably the best procedure for now until there's clarification on the process. And I just wanted to point out that there is an informal rule that city council has advised that they'd like to see kept in place, which is that for items coming to council for review, either at study session or a regular meeting, the minutes must be adopted and then available to city council prior to that presentation. So again, especially if you have a timing issue, there is the option for electronic approval of minutes, but again, just be proactive. If you know there's an issue that you want to be in front of city council, work with your council liaison on the timing of that so that you can have your minutes approved and in front of city council before the issuance. All right, and I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this either, but bylaws, some of you have them, some of you do not. If it was okay if you do not. We encourage you to review these on a consistent basis, especially with the relationship to the rules of order. So if you have anything conflicting in your bylaws, the bottom rules of order, it's wise to go back and amend your bylaws if you will be utilizing bottom rules of order. And as a best practice, it's good to just annually review your bylaws if you have them and if you don't already. Some do, some don't worry if you don't. But if you have any questions on what those might be, feel free to let us know. And a few highlights on member roles and responsibilities. Conflicts of interest, it should be pretty clear. You know, there's a number of different examples. Certainly if your professional side and your job has is doing work with the city and that issue is in front of the Board of Commission, certainly that's something that you should disclose and probably recuse yourself from the deliberation and any action of the Board of Commission. Sometimes, and if you know it's not impacting your decision, that there's no impropriety, perhaps you're just worried about appearance, maybe disclosing that to the Board of Commission is adequate. I think in this way, you certainly want to err on the side of caution.
I'm going to step in on this question too, because this is actually a question of law. Conflict of interest under the law, if you have a fiduciary, basically a fiduciary relationship, or there's a fiduciary issue, meaning money's involved, that's when the law states that you should state that you have a conflict of interest. You live in a community. We're talking about the community you live in. So someone will say, well, I go to church with this person who's applying for planning and zoning. Yeah, because we live in a community, you do. That's not a conflict of interest. Well, he lives three houses down. That's not a conflict of interest under the law. Conflict of interest is, that's my employee, that's my boss, that's my accountant who I pay regularly. The accountant thing, honestly, I think that that's a fact-based, you know, situation by situation. But if you have some kind of financial relationship with the individual or with the situation, you need to state it on the record. Does anybody have any questions about conflict of interest? Because again, because it's a legal issue, I want to make sure nobody's confused about that. That's the only area you can abstain and have the right to abstain, even if the rest of the body doesn't want you to.
So I know with the Historic Preservation Commission, I lived at a Rabbi Whitner's. So the idea is, do I get money from the involvement? Well, yeah, I own my house in a Rabbi Whitner's in the historic district. So if we start dealing with historic district stuff, do you see what I'm talking about here?
I don't think the fact that you own, I think that that's too attenuated.
Thank you.
If Arapaho Acres hired you to be their PR lady and they were giving you a check, then yeah, you need to state that. But again, yes, I had a question come up at my previous city. One of the city council members, she tithed to her church, basically it's a church we both attended, she tithed every week. And the church had a PUD issue coming up before the city council. And she said, do I need to declare that as a conflict of interest? I have a fiduciary relationship with my church. And I said, you can state on the record that that is your church, but the fact is there are seven churches in this city. All of you belong to one of them. All of them have issues. You aren't their employee. I think that that's very attenuated, and I wouldn't directly call that a conflict of interest. Now, if she wanted to, it was her right to call it. If she's asking me as the attorney, I wouldn't have. The same thing. You live in Arapaho Acres. Yes, of course, you pay taxes or those kinds of things, but I just think that's too attenuated. You really need to look at who you're writing checks to directly and who's writing checks to you directly. Yeah.
If you have a financial conflict of interest, are you required then to recuse or abstain?
Yes. Under state law, you are required.
If there's a disagreement on the board, How is that resolved?
The individual gets to make that decision. And this sometimes annoys people because an individual, well, the case that most often happens is I'm on the council and I work for a school district and I happen to work at Joe Jones School. The school district itself is coming asking for a PUD on Smith School. They have 50 schools in the school district. Yeah, I get a paycheck from the school district, but I don't have anything to do with that school, so I'm going to say, no, I don't perceive I have a conflict of interest. Now, I'll state it on the record. I do work for the school district, but I'm not in any way associated with that school or this matter. I'm not going to declare a conflict of interest. Well, four other people are pretty sure they know how I'm going to vote. They're a little annoyed with me. They're pretty much counting on me abstaining. And so they're going to say, well, are you sure you're getting in? And they go back and forth, and they might want to question me about it, but in the end, it's my decision. And if it turns out that someone files with the district attorney that I've acted outside of my fiduciary responsibilities, I'm the one responsible for the choice.
So it's my understanding of fiduciary responsibility is one that also goes beyond financial, and it's putting the interests of others ahead of one's own interests, regardless of the financial position. Is that correct?
No, I think that is a much broader read than state statute requires. State statute is very clear that it's a money thing. The only thing that the statute discusses that I think is applicable to anything that you guys would be working with is I own a printing company, and Joe Jones Printing Company is wanting to get a contract with my committee. I don't like him. I don't like that. He does bad printing. And if I vote against him, there is a rule under the conflict of interest rule saying that you can't use your position to harm a business competitor. So
I'm a little confused here, so help me to understand this. So I'll say the lady over here owns a home in a particular neighborhood, and she believes she has a financial interest. Okay, I'm not pointing her out just as an example. But that person believes they have a financial interest in not doing something. And so they vote no against whatever proposal is in front of them because they believe the neighborhood is better to stay as it is. Okay? While they are a resident, they also have an interest in it because they're in that neighborhood. Does that disqualify them or put the city in harm's way relative to any legal action under state statutes?
It does not put the city in any harm's way. It is their decision. And to give this a little bit of context, because that's a great example, Susie states on the record, I live in Arapaho Acres, but I don't feel that I have any type of conflict of interest on that, therefore I won't be participating in the vote. John says, point of information, and then comes back with, I don't see how you perceive that you don't have a conflict of interest because I perceive you do X, Y, and Z. And Susie will respond, I hear what you're saying, but I don't perceive it that way, and therefore I'm not declaring a conflict of interest. So there can be a discussion, and especially the place I see this happen most is planning and zoning. So there can be an issue, but in the end, it's that individual's decision, and no, there's not a specific liability issue. The question actually for the city, let me finish that sentence, there's not a specific liability issue for the city. The question is if planning and zoning makes a decision against something, and planning and zoning, again, it's an easy one for me to pick on, but they make a decision against something, and then the applicant who has the right to file an appeal of any decision at some point files an appeal of the final decision and says, well, clear back the planning and zoning. Member Susie participated. Member Susie has a conflict of interest. That can be discussed as part of the litigation of the appeal. But that's really far beyond where you guys need to worry about. For purposes of deciding conflict of interest, I really would like to keep it simple, and that is, if you have a fiduciary interest, you need to declare it. And if you have a conflict of interest, you need to declare it and abstain. And in the end, it's each member's decision about conflict of interest. The rest of the body may question under point of order, but in the end, it's that member's decision.
And in that instance, an abstention is not counted as a no vote, correct?
Okay, under Robert's rules, abstentions don't exist. So right now, most of you are operating under Robert's rules. The nice thing about Bob's rules is it recognizes abstentions and it calls that a no vote. But if you haven't adopted Bob's rules, an abstention just doesn't exist.
So it is covered as a no vote?
No, we had an abstention at the city council
right.
a few weeks ago, and it wasn't counted one way or the other. It's as if that person was not voting at all.
Okay.
I won't do that. What I will do is send out a copy of the law and let you all read it yourself. One of the most difficult things for all of us is we all interpret terms of art within our own expertise. And if you are a financial expert, you understand the broad scope and all the potential implications of a term. I'm just going back to what the statute states, and it's actually pretty clear. So, yeah, we can certainly, and what we'll do is send those out to the chair, and that way each body that wants to, the chair can distribute it out to their bodies, and you guys can discuss how you want to deal with that.
Thank you. All right, I'll speed up these last few slides. I have officially lied on the time. Attendance policy, just so you're aware, is 75%. Especially if you're interested in continuing on a board or commission, by the policy, you should attend at least 3/4 of board or commission meetings. And lastly, code of conduct. We are, I just will note, working on a board and commission member manual. We haven't finalized that yet. It would include a lot of the stuff we covered tonight, so that is actually a document that you can refer to. But one of those that you should be aware of is gifts and gratuities. Again, normal course of the day, you're meeting with a member, you buy each other a cup of coffee. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, I'll use this example since we don't have one anymore, but we have a liquor board and there's a license coming up and the bar owner, you know, buys you a dinner and a drink. I mean, that's where it gets into the gifts and gratuities. So just be aware of that, and perception is important with that. And role of the city attorney's office, I think Allison was going to say a bit about our city attorney's office.
Very briefly, if you are a board or commission that is interested in modifications to the code, please don't write the code yourself. Working through your chair and your council staff liaison, send your information through to the city attorney's office and let us review that and figure out how that would actually fit within the code. I don't think people realize that when you change one section here, it impacts 14 other sections and how those are interpreted. So it's not straightforward and it's not easy. I think I've got one body that's already sent some stuff to us for review, and I really appreciate that. But your job is not to write code. Your job is to figure out where you think the code is lacking and discuss that with your board or commission and then send it through to us. And if we have questions, we'll certainly send that back to you and open a dialogue on that. If it's something that we can do, we'll do that as well. We will attend quasi-judicial hearings. I think Dugan Comer goes to the planning and zoning meetings. I'm not sure if other ones come up, we'll assign somebody to attend those to just give you the support that you might want or need. If you have questions on the law, like we're asked about the conflict of interest law, what exactly is that? Ask us. It's our job to support you and make sure that you have answers on that. And again, if there's general legal issues, have your chair working through your staff liaison to reach out. Again, most of these questions are pretty fast for us, so we can get a response back. If you're asking us to write code or write an ordinance or go back and figure out a code or ordinance thing, that's probably going to take us 30 days. And if you send it through this last month where I was out with about a week sick, we're a little bit behind that. But for the most part, we can get back on those questions pretty quick.
Thank you. And then lastly, we did have a little bit more on quasi-judicial bodies. We did spend a little bit more time. Is there anything in particular that we haven't covered that you want to cover? I think the important thing here is, and for those on quasi-judicial boards, just that you're making sure that you're consistent with the code if it defines standards. I know especially for some of our planning and zoning issues, we've been working on a standard to try to help with a matrix. So for others, if you need help with that, again, just make sure that you're looking at the code and anything that authorizes you as a body, and that you're sticking to that documentation that follows in line with your authorization. Again, everything for quasi-judicial builds on everything else, so that recommendation eventually comes to the City Council, and that decision has to be properly discussed, articulated, and then justified in the end. So a little bit more pressure on all of you. But for those on those boards and commissions, if you have questions in addition to that, feel free to let us know. All right. There were many questions along the way. Are there any other final questions?
I just want to confirm that commission's meeting anywhere as long as it's reflected on the agenda.
I'm sorry, what was that? That's right, within the city of Englewood.
I have one more quick one that occurs to me. When you say quorum is half plus one, if you're on an odd number board, like with seven members for a quorum?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So one in the back?
Yes, regarding advisory boards, is it appropriate for a council member to be liaison make a motion on something that will be advised back to City Council?
So for council liaisons, it's one of the issues that we're working with City Council on right now is to clarify the role of council liaisons. For now, I would refer to your specific bylaws or ordinances if it's defined. It varies right now.
The other issue you have is that some boards, commissions, advisory bodies, the council member is actually named as a member of that board, commission, or advisory body. In others, they're merely a liaison, which means they show up to hear what you're saying so they can take that information back to the council. So how your individual body or advisory body deals with that is dependent on the defined role of the council member for that advisory. So each one of you are going to have a different answer to that.
And I'm talking about a voting council member, voting member of the advisory committee. I guess it's always been my opinion that was inappropriate.
If the council member is actually a member of the body, they are a member of the body for all purposes. So yes, they can make motions, they can second, even though it comes back to the City Council and they're part of the City Council that reviews that decision. But if the enabling legislation made a council member, or in one case two council members, members of the body, they act as any other member of that committee, board, commission, advisory body, whatever it is.
My committee doesn't have bylaws, and I was hoping maybe you could clarify the role of an alternate member in support of the quorum.
alternate members are, serve the role of being a backup. So they don't just, they are not just appointed by council so that they can show up to the meeting and grin a lot. They're actually appointed to serve a role, and their role is to show up to the meeting, and if you're missing a member, they step in and act as a voting member. You don't need to ask their permission, and that's why alternate members, it's so critical that they attend all of the meetings, because it's like being an alternate juror. If something happens to one of the regular members, this person needs to be up to date on everything so that they can step right in and be an active member of the decision. The only time that doesn't apply is in the quasi-judicial situation. You've started a public hearing, and nobody, an alternate member cannot step in the middle of a public hearing and participate. Once the public hearing is started, whoever the body was who's acting as the hearing body, that's established. It doesn't change. If someone is out sick, well, then you're short a member. But except for that quasi-judicial public hearing situation of alternate member, it for every board and commission votes if there is an opening any particular meeting night.
And I guess as a corollary to that, if we have two alternates present, one regular member missing, how would we decide which alternate?
I think that's up to the chair.
I've seen it done in other cities where the board or commission establishes who's the first and second alternate, just so there's no question.
On the 75% attendance rule, what if someone falls short?
The 75% attendance rule, if it's noted by the chair of the body, then that someone's been gone more than 75%. Somebody makes a motion to request that the city council review this person's membership on the board because they have not been in full attendance. And then that request is sent to the city council, and the city council reviews it.
And the attendance is also noted for reappointments as well in that information that goes to council. Anything else? We will make this presentation and the full Bob's Rules of Order available to you. Also, the one pager, we'll get it laminated so every board commission has it. Make sure staff liaisons have that for you so that you can review it. We'll notify you through your staff liaisons when that information is available. I hope this was at least somewhat helpful tonight. I understand that some of it's new, so it'll take some time to get used to. If you have questions, let us know. Any one of us are happy to attend your board commission and answer questions at any time. So, yes?
With the recording, is it going to be, we're going to be given a link and then we can just open it up? Or?
Yes, we'll work on that. I'm not sure what format, but it'll be available online. Thank you for coming this evening. Appreciate your time.